Mr. Hadley, Steve, welcome to Empire. Your assessment of the American-Russian agreement on chemical weapons?
It's a start. It needs to be elaborated in terms of detail. I think rightly they're going to try to get it enshrined in a UN Security Council resolution. I think that's also a good step. It sets out a very ambitious timetable for getting control of and ultimately destroying these weapons. And it's a very difficult, it's a challenging time frame and timetable because this will all have to be done in the middle of a very bloody war.
Did it surprise you that the Russians and the Americans agreed on such an agreement with such a short time scale, like 7 days for Syria to divulge in all the details of its chemical weapon program and so on?
Yes, but it has echoes of Iraq in 2003 when Saddam Hussein accepted an arrangement which had him, I think, within 30 days submitting an inventory of all his weapons of mass destruction, either saying that he had them or documenting that he had destroyed them. And of course the document that he provided was woefully inadequate and viewed as inadequate not just by the United States but by the United Nations. So that will be the test for Assad. Is he really going to play this game in good faith, or is this going to be a tool that he will use to delay and delay and to buy off an American military strike while he doubles down and tries to liquidate the opposition, which he's been trying to do for some time now?
I want to get to the Iraq bit soon, but just to stay with Syria for a bit. You were for the strike originally. You were for striking Syria.
I said that when the President of the United States calls on the Congress and seeks authorization to do a strike, that he should be supported. That I was not a big fan of where we are in our Syria policy, but I thought it would be a real disaster for his credibility and American credibility if, having asked the Congress for authorization, the Congress were to turn him down. And I said that very strongly.
But you also wanted the strike to be far greater, far more hurting of the Assad regime than what the Obama administration anticipated.
Yes, not for any reasons of vindictiveness or punishment, but the United States really has at least four interests in what's going on in Syria. One is to ensure that there is no repetition. I would say this, to impose consequences for the chemical use that Syria has already done and make sure there is no repetition of it. But we also have an interest in bringing to the end a war that has been a humanitarian disaster for the Syrian people, a war that is increasing sectarian and is spreading beyond its borders and risks destabilizing Lebanon, Iraq, Jordan, and Turkey, and a war that is facilitating al-Qaeda building a safe haven in northern Syria from which it can threaten not only Syrians but the region and the United States. And then finally, of course, this is an effort by Iran to, through Hezbollah, to extend its hegemony. Those are all important U.S. interests, and I would have liked to see a strategy by the administration that would have used a strike to advance and all of those interests.
But one could argue that a stronger strike would actually do exactly the contrary in all these four points you mentioned. They could strengthen al-Qaeda, they could lead to chaos, and the chaos could overspill to neighboring countries. They could lead the Assad regime to take major vengeful acts against the population. I mean, everything could backfire as far as the four points
you're saying. That's already happening. That's already happening, and if we do nothing, that's exactly what will happen. More people will die. It'll be more sectarian. We'll open the door more for al-Qaeda. And it's pretty clear that Assad is already, during the week of the negotiations, had doubled down. So those are the things that happen if we don't do something. What could have happened if we had done a strike was something that would not only enforce the prohibition of chemical weapons, but would have set back Assad militarily, would have sent the message that this man is not going to win this war. And that, I think, followed by training and arming of the opposition, would have leveled the playing field a bit on the ground in Syria and would have opened the door for a negotiated outcome, which is neither Assad wins and stays, nor that the opposition wins, but that Assad regime splits and some elements of the regime and the military form with the democratic opposition to form an interim government that can bring stability, start winding down the war, and take care of al-Qaeda in the north, which threatens everybody. So I would say doing nothing leads to those outcomes you described. What we had was a chance to write a different future.
It's been going on for 2 years, 100,000 people died. None of that really happened. I mean, there was some symbolic support for the opposition, but nothing really serious. And now what you're advocating, your detractors say, would something be more of a lethal attack that could lead to a major chaos within the country in the absence of that support to the opposition?
Well, I would have had a attack. It would still have been limited. It was an effort to deal a setback to the Assad regime, and I would have coupled it with some training and arming of the opposition. Interestingly, the administration says that they are going to do training and arming, something they announced in June, but have been very slow to do. I think that's the right policy.
But especially under pressure from the Republican leadership, right, in Congress.
Well, you know, some of us have been arguing for training and arming of the opposition for about 18 months. And the administration has been reluctant to do it, slow to do it, only announced they were going to do it in June. I hope they will now accelerate that process and will stand firm against explicit calls by President Assad and others to suspend and not to arm the opposition. I think that would be an invitation basically to saying to President Assad, you have a blank check to kill as many as you want to reestablish your control over the country, and I think it's a disaster for the region and a disaster for the Syrian people. It would send a clear message to the region that it is okay to maintain power by killing hundreds of thousands of your own people. And why anybody thinks that's a good message, I don't know.
Well, okay, so two things. First of all, on this issue, I think we're moving forward without addressing this at all. I mean, Assad is probably strengthening now that there is an agreement that simply deals with the chemical, doesn't deal with any other aspect of that
yes.
thing. So this is going to go on unabated. The whole America as the moral power thing is certainly not working in Syria.
Well, I think the reason for that is that we defined our interests narrowly only to the chemical weapons issue, whereas I've described, I think we have other interests, the killing itself, the spreading to neighboring states, destabilizing the region, the providing a base for al-Qaeda and a victory for Iran. So my only yeah. point is that we're in this position because we've defined our interests too narrowly and did not have a strategy that addressed all of our interests. That's the problem.
Mr. Hadley, the elephant in this room, the elephant in this city, the elephant in this country, the elephant in this world is all about Iraq versus Syria. Everyone looks back at your policy in Iraq and seems everything is valued in comparison to that war. It's the trillion-dollar mistake. It's the hundreds of thousands of people dying because of American policy in Iraq. And everyone's looking at the option in Syria in comparison to that war. This, your detractors say, how dare the Republicans, how dare the Bush officials lecture the Obama administration about war in Syria after Iraq?
I don't think we are lecturing them. I think many Republicans, such as myself, have been supportive of the Obama administration, was supportive of the president's call for authorization from Congress. I went up and met with a couple hundred Republican staff to urge them to vote a resolution that would support President Obama.
When you supported,
so I think that is hardly lecturing. Secondly, you know, it's very interesting. Estimates range. I think the number I think most people say is 130,000 civilians died in 7 years of war in Iraq. Over 200,000 have died in Syria in just a little bit over 2 years. Tell a lot of the Iraqis people that the war was not worth it in Iraq. A lot of them are actually quite glad that Saddam Hussein is gone and they're able to chart their own future.
They're dying by the hundreds every week.
They are now.
Today.
And you know one of the reasons why? Primarily?
Because of what you left.
No. At the end of 2008, the violence was down dramatically, and it stayed down for 3-4 years. It is going up now, and it is going up now precisely because of what's going on in Syria. And that is fanning sectarian tensions, and that is spilled over into Iraq, and you now have Iraqi Sunni and Shia fighting each other in Syria.
But you don't see that as an inheritance from the Iraq war?
No, I think that is an inheritance from the violence in Syria that we have not used all of our influence to bring to an end. And it has also resulted in the resurgence of Al-Qaeda, which was on its back, and the administration would tell you this, was on its back from 2008 and 2011, 2012. Well, Al-Qaeda is now back. And again, it's because of what the ongoing war in Syria is doing to Iraq, is doing in Lebanon today, and risks doing in Jordan, both because of the sectarian spillover and the hundreds of thousands of refugees that are coming out of Syria and destabilizing Lebanon, Iraq, and Jordan. That's the problem of in Iraq today, is what's happening in Syria.
2 points just to clarify. You're not actually saying that the hundreds of thousands of people who died in Iraq are in any way okay just because more people are dying in Syria.
Not at all. I'm trying to underscore the scale of the tragedy in Syria, just like there was no question, a tragedy in Iraq in terms of the hundreds of 100,000, 130,000 people who died. It is clear we made mistakes in Iraq. There's no question about it in the period after the war. We made mistakes. But there was something useful that was achieved in Iraq, and at enormous cost to the Iraqi people, to the Americans, the coalition, and that is being jeopardized by what's happening in Syria.
But have we learned the ultimate lesson, which is that force, military force, does not resolve political problems, and certainly does not resolve sectarian issues? It was after military power was used with such magnitude that we've seen Iraq explode. Aren't you afraid that the same will get worse in Syria as it did in Iraq?
It's getting worse in Syria precisely because we're doing nothing. And secondly,
But how does military force resolve it?
I would remind you that in 2008, when we left office, you had a unity government and you had Sunni, Shia, and Kurds working together for a common future. That is now under great pressure, largely from what is happening in Syria. I think the lesson we learn, and people are drawing, that the reason, many people are saying, that the reason there is an agreement on chemical weapons in Syria today is precisely because the diplomacy was backed by the threat of military force. I think that's the lesson you learn.
You don't think the limit of American military force is a lesson to be learned in your last decade or two policy in the Middle East?
No, I think the military piece of what we did in Iraq succeeded. We found a military strategy that did bring down and largely end the sectarian war and did largely eliminate Al-Qaeda's
But it started the sectarian
resurgence.
War. Pardon me? 2003, there was no sectarian war in Iraq.
No. My point is that what would happen in the aftermath of 2003 was a sectarian war. No question about that.
And thanks to the use of power. Thanks to the war.
Thanks
the invasion,
to the, use of
the occupation.
Power, and also thanks to decades of what the rule of Saddam Hussein did to the Iraqi people. And you ought to, if you haven't, you ought to interview some Iraqis and talk about what his rule did to the people of Iraq. What we learned was military power could topple a regime. Military power was not enough to reconstruct a society that had suffered from 3 decades of abuse by Saddam and a war. That's what we learned. But in the end of the day, after the president's decision in 2007 for the surge, we had a strategy that did bring down the sectarian violence, did largely eliminate Al-Qaeda, and had a relatively stable Iraq where Sunni, Shia, and Kurds were working together in a common future. And the lesson we learned, unfortunately, too well, was watch out for sins of commission. Watch out for using military power when you don't have a plan. But what we're learning in Syria is there are also sins of omission. And if you fail to deal with some of these situations, it can have the kinds of disastrous consequences we're seeing today.
Would you agree with me, putting Iraq and other issues on the side, that the American people are not in agreement with you? that the American people's response to the will for an action in Syria was all measured by what they considered as the failure in Iraq, as the wrong war, as a stupid war, as the Senator Obama called
it. There are a lot of people who say that. I think if you look at some of the polls and if you look at some of the conversations with Americans, I would say two things. One, remember this administration for 5 years has been telling the American people Iraq was a terrible mistake, nothing was accomplished, we should never do it again. While he has been waged a war in Afghanistan, all he talks about is bringing the troops home. And for 2 years, he's been telling the American people, we don't have any interest in what's going on in Syria. And the problem was, I mean, on the basis of that kind of conditioning of the American people, suddenly he comes forward and says, I want authority to strike. I think he was right to do so, but in some sense, he had made his bed and conditioned the American people to be very skeptical about it. Secondly,
So you think he embraced Bush's policies?
No.
War policies in Afghanistan?
Well, we know, as a matter of fact, that he increased the number of troops in Afghanistan.
Exactly.
And has been trying, not embracing Bush's war policy, he made his own decision.
But that's what you find
what
funny.
That was going on in Afghanistan threatened American interests, and therefore we needed to make.
But that's what you find paradoxical.
I don't find it paradoxical.
I mean, you were laughing just earlier. He said this is wrong, but then he adopted it.
I think the problem is he has in a way conditioned the American public in a way that made it harder for him to get the authorization he sought. I think he was right to do so. But as a practical matter, he had made it more difficult for himself. And secondly, I think he has not persuaded the American people that our interests are at stake and that their interests worth potentially using force for. And I think that's partly because he's confined it to the chemical weapons issue and not embrace the full set of interests that I've tried to describe to you.
Don't think the idea of the use of force in the Middle East is in principle a bad idea that should be avoided at all costs?
I don't think it should be avoided at all cost any more than I think we should be hasty in using the military instrument. But I think we have seen once again in this agreement on chemical weapons that for diplomacy to be effective, it has to be backed by consequences. And use of force can be one of those consequences.
But you actually supported Secretary Rumsfeld's proposition that this should be a military strike that would simply decapitate the Assad regime.
I never said that, and I'm not saying that now.
Okay.
What I've said was we should have used the occasion to do a strike that would have caused consequences for his chemical use, would have helped to deter and degrade his chemical weapons capability, but would have also have set back his military as part of a strategy of leveling the playing field.
Changing the course of war.
Changing the balance of war on the ground, followed by an arming and training of the opposition so you could get the kind of negotiated outcome that could bring an end to this war, provide a basis for an inclusive Syria of all ethnic and religious groups, and might bring some, hopefully over time, some stability to this region.
But you don't think that's more theoretical than it is practical, judging from past experiences?
I think given the fact that we have not had this kind of strategy for 18 months, it makes it a lot harder. But if you ask yourself, what are the alternatives? The alternatives are Assad wins and establishes the principle that it's okay to slaughter your own people. The more extremist elements of the opposition win, in which case you have a real problem of the breakup of Syria, or it descends into chaos, or you have this kind of indefinite war that will kill more people, become more sectarian, destabilize the neighborhood, and open the door for al-Qaeda. None of the alternatives serve anybody's interests.
We're going to let you go.
There you go.
Thank you. Thank you so much.